Want to work with wildlife but you've got no idea where to start? Watch this video for a quick step-by-step guide. Lions roaring in the morning sun, searching for a longer day. Hi, welcome to Diary of a Tent Wife. For videos on careers and behind the scenes of working in conservation, subscribe to this channel and click that bell notification to see new videos every Sunday. If you want to work with wildlife or in conservation and you have no idea where to start, by the end of this video you should be able to have some tips to get you closer to your dream job. These are things that work for me, so why not for you? My first tip is to start volunteering as early as you can. I've chatted about volunteering in another video which I'll link below, but this is really looking at volunteering locally, especially if you have an idea of what you want to do when you're younger. This is the perfect thing to do when you're 16, 17, 18, just got out of school, volunteering in your local area with a humane shelter, a rehab clinic, a zoo, a beach cleanup, countryside cleanup, anything that will help you get in some kind of conservation organization experience or on their radar. You might feel that you want to research lions in Kenya, for example. You might not see how starting in, say, volunteering in the RSPCA will help you, but it really will help you. So I would say don't be so restricted of what you want to do when you're older. Just volunteer anywhere that you can get a chance to volunteer. It will get you a foot in the door. It'll get you onto your next volunteering task or your next volunteering project, which might then get you closer. And remember, this is looking at before you're kind of studying. So it's just getting a bit of experience and a bit of exposure to the conservation world. So for this, I would suggest you look up organizations in your area. It can be quite hard to find volunteering positions on kind of search engine websites, although environmentaljob.co.uk, there are a few on there. For this kind of volunteering, I would suggest you actually look at the organizations in your area, go onto their website, onto their social media, and just see if they've got any opportunities. If not, just write to them, at least get on their radar. They might have something that comes up, especially in school holidays, in the summer, that they might then contact you and say, you know, would you like to come and help? Even a couple of days would be very useful. And then you might end up having like a regular, say, Saturday helping out. So the second thing is looking into courses. There are loads and loads of courses in the UK related to conservation, working with wildlife, working with animals. I won't list them all: conservation biology, ecology, animal behavior, although at BSc level it's generally zoology and then specializes in animal behavior, wildlife conservation, ecology and wildlife conservation, like general kind of biology broad degrees. There are so many. I actually looked up the courses that are currently on offer yesterday, and I'll list these either below in the description or a separate PDF document, maybe with the links to what universities. But there are a huge amount of courses and they all vary slightly. They have a lot of overlapping between them, so it's looking at what might be best for you. Some of the courses I came across are very, very specific, so like marine biology or marine zoology, zoology and entomology, so insects, or aquaculture and fisheries. I think I saw one BSc was that. That's fine if you know exactly what you want to do, but I would suggest if you aren't sure what you want to do, go for a broader degree like ecology or biology, just to get you to kind of experience different aspects of it and find out where you want to go. These courses are from searching in the UK. That's kind of my experience. I'm not sure about other countries. I presume, especially in America, there would be very, very similar courses. In the UK as well, there are a number of courses that have kind of a sandwich year, a gap year in between them, or they've got a professional placement or kind of an extended research project in a setting, even at BSc level. And I would really, really recommend doing a course like that that actually gets you exposure to conservation organizations nearby or even far, just so you're actually getting some practical experience. Because as I've said in other videos, Just having your degree is not enough nowadays. You need to get experience and you need to get your foot in the door. So it's perfect if you can actually do this while you are studying. There are also other courses like wildlife education, media, natural history, media. I will actually do another video, I think, that's looking at ways to get into conservation without a science background, because I think people don't realize that there are actually quite a few ways to work in the conservation setting and get exposure to animals and wildlife and the environment and working kind of in the field where you don't have to be a scientist. There are many job roles, and if it's something you're interested in, then let me know in the comments below and I will make another video kind of outlining those jobs as well. Ah, the sun is coming up! You might not need a graduate degree for what you want to go into. If you want to get a bit more understanding of that, then watch my video on what is an ethologist. It kind of outlines things that you might not need a degree for, so I'll link that into the video as well. There are also a lot of opportunities to do kind of online or distance learning course if you want to kind of broaden your skills while you're already working. I haven't done any online courses, but my husband has done one through Compass in the UK, and I've got a former colleague who's done one through Animal Jobs, and they both say Animal Jobs Direct, I think it is. I'll link them both below. They both say good things, and there seems to be a wide variety of courses that you can do, and again, some of them do have practical placements in England, which I think is really, really good as well. Just have a good read through, see what it covers, see who it's accredited by, see like if there's any progression, because some of them can be sort of a foundation, and then if you get on well and enjoy it and you think it's worthwhile, then you can go on further and do kind of a higher one, which is what Theo did. You should definitely do your homework before you do any of them. A lot of them have like even online quick chats, you can ask as many questions as you want to, so do your own research before you do any of these. So I mentioned while you're doing your course or while you're studying at uni, getting experience is crucial. Getting even like a day or so, getting to just have a taste of a conservation organization, exposure to them, little bit of experience, it's all really good for your CV. And the more that you can do that while you're still at university and you've not got a full-time job and other pressures, then try and get that done as quickly as possible. Sorry, there's a big shadow on my face. So internships again, where I have looked in the past has been environmentaljobs.co.uk. Again, I'll link below. But again, these can be really hard to search for if you're just kind of Googling them. A lot of pay to internship ones come up. Again, what I would suggest, especially if you're doing it locally, is just find the organizations themselves. Go to their website, look in their career opportunities or job vacancies, look in those sections. Again, if they don't have them, send them your CV, get on their radar. See, even if they have like an open day or they're organizing a beach cleanup day or something that you can go and take part of and actually chat to someone face to face, just go and do that and get your foot in the door. It's all about making connections. So go to the websites like RSPB, WWF, Flora and Fauna. There are so many. Again, I'll link them below. So you build connections where you would want to work one day, or where they have a lot of organisations in the UK have then projects that they support all over the world. And I give an example of one of our donors, the David Shepherd Wildlife Foundation, DSWF. They have their main offices in the UK, they have volunteers in the UK, but they support organisations like ours all over the world. And we've had people who were past volunteers there that have become so kind of invested in the projects that they've come out to visit, and then it's kind of gone on from there. So look at organisations. You might not think you want to volunteer or stay in the UK, but look at what connections they have in other countries. Okay, after you've got some experience, you've got your courses down, then you need to really look at your CV. The biggest tip I would say with CVs is not to use kind of vague words. You need to have evidence, and your experience needs to demonstrate why you're using those words for yourself. So like, there's no point saying I'm passionate and I care about wildlife it's been a joke between me and a couple of people I work with that the more passionate we read in the cover letter, the less likely we are of actually employing that person, because you need to show straight away, demonstrate why you're passionate. Don't just say you're passionate. Demonstrate what you have done. You've spent however many days cleaning beaches, you've picked up this amount of litter, you've gone for this, you've raised money for this organization. Just always give evidence to why you are describing yourself in a way that you are. Put any fieldwork experience, any research experience, anything that you've done with charities, as I've said in a number of videos, your soft skills, anything like that that you've done, put it in there. Really research the organization well that you are intending to apply for. Clearly pick out things from their job description and show them quite prominently in your cover letter and in your CV. Some important qualities for working in conservation: problem solving, communication skills, critical thinking skills, emotional stamina. Like, it's really, really important if you're working with animals that you don't get over emotional and upset, because you are going to experience dying animals, sick animals, very upsetting circumstances. If you're working in an environment where there's poaching around, there will be things that you're exposed to, so you will have to kind of demonstrate that you are kind of not mature, but that you're not easily kind of upset or flustered by things, that you've got a very kind of down-to-earth thinking and a very practical way of the bigger picture. I know that can be hard, but it is something that you will have to develop when you're working with animals. To have good interpersonal skills, good outdoor skills. So that's something you can even demonstrate from when you were younger. Like, if you did D of E in England, it's Duke of Edinburgh Award. If you're keen to get out there, did you go camping a lot when you were younger? Did you do a lot of kind of mountain walking or hikes? Anything that shows that you're kind of keen on the outdoors. If you can put that in like your hobby section, and you show that you are kind of, you look like you would cope in a kind of a remote environment, that would be really, really good. So I might do another video, a more in-depth video on CVs. Let me know below if that's something you're interested in. Write yes CVs please in the comments. So what jobs do people do in conservation? Again, this is from my experience, so kind of UK, Zambia, South Africa. Work as obviously ethologists or wildlife researchers. They work in rehab clinics, animal shelters, wildlife rescue, working for animal related charities, NGOs like myself, working as a vet, working in zoos, being a game warden, being a marine biologist, wildlife officer, an ecologist. There are a huge amount of jobs that studying wildlife, studying conservation can get you into, both locally in England, which surprises a lot of people I think, and abroad. So where should you look for employment opportunities? Again, talking from a UK perspective, I found that environmentaljobs.co.uk, this is not sponsored by them, but it sounds like it is, but it is generally what I've used in the past, and I still get weekly emails or updates from them as to what jobs are sort of related to my field. I obviously haven't been looking for a job for the last kind of 5 years, but I still get them because I still feel like it's interesting to know kind of what's out there. It's interesting to see how jobs in the UK especially get paid a lot more. Ecologists, there have been some very high paying jobs in ecology that I've seen. I must have gone down the wrong career path for making money, but it's easier to look for jobs on general search engines, I think, than it is for volunteering and internship opportunities. Again, it's good to go on their actual websites, and even if they don't have jobs, just kind of keep them on your favorites tab and have a look every now and again. Get alerts on from their social media. A lot of smaller NGOs like us at GRI, when we advertise jobs, they actually go on our website and on our social media. We don't tend to put them on job sites because they actually cost quite a lot of money to put jobs on there, and it's just something that we've got better things to spend money on, and we've got quite a good social media following, so we kind of hope that we can get exposure to enough people that way. So I would say don't always rely on the job sites and job searches. Really get a clear understanding of the organizations that are out there. Do a bit of homework, get a list together of them, and routinely, like even once a week or once every couple of weeks, Just check them and see what's going on. You never know. And write to them directly. Ask them to keep your CV on file. It's happened to us lots of times. We've, even before advertising a job, we've already kind of received a few CVs for other positions, or just generally that we would kind of contact them and say, like, you know, this job is being advertised. You might find it suitable for you. Like, please do apply. Obviously, a lot of organizations might not have time for that. So don't be afraid to kind of, don't pester people, but don't be afraid to kind of send your CV and just outline in your email. Best to put, you know, a few sentences, kind of your hook of your employability in the actual email, because people are busy. They might not have time to open your CV, but it might be enough just to read a little bit about you to then put you into kind of a file that they will then remember you and possibly contact you in the future. Again, I'll link to some of these organizations below. So that's it. I will do maybe longer videos on some of these aspects. If you're interested in hearing about it, just let me know. If you like this video, please let me know by hitting that like button below. Hit subscribe and share it with anyone who you think would find it useful. I think that's it. Okay, thanks, bye. Davidson better not be driving in here. Theo?
Yes?
Davidson, you're messing up my video.
Why is he coming over?
Hold on. Morning! You're going for firewood.
Alright, bye bye.
Okay, bye bye. Sunday firewood day.